join Haunted Britain as we're about to investigate what's reported as being one of the most active haunted locations here in the very historic town of Stratford-upon-Avon in Warwickshire. We're currently standing on Henley Street, best known for being William Shakespeare's birthplace. He was actually born in the building behind me in 1564. And the property we're going to be investigating tonight was also built in the 1500s and is located just two doors down at number 21 Henley Street. Join Haunted Britain as we investigate the very creepy Creaky Cauldron. Approximately 100 miles northwest of London sits the very historic market town of Stratford-upon-Avon in the county of Warwickshire, best known to tourists today as Shakespeare's County. The 16th century Tudor period is perhaps Stratford's most significant and fascinating time historically. Stratford is best known as being the birthplace of William Shakespeare, born in the very heart of this market town on Henley Street in 1564, the very same year as one-fifth of Stratford's population was lost to the plague, which tragically struck the town again less than 100 years later in 1645. This wasn't the only record of Stratford's tragic past. In 1594, Stratford experienced its first of three fires. It destroyed a great part of the town, including many buildings on Henley Street. Thankfully, it didn't destroy Shakespeare's house, nor all of the building we're about to investigate. The Creaky Cauldron claims to have extensive paranormal activities, and the Haunted Britain team are here to unearth the truth as to whether one of Stratford's oldest surviving Tudor buildings is indeed haunted.
If you were going to visit the Creaky Cauldron, why would you come? 500 years of history, several levels, people that died, adventure, murder, old rooms, new rooms, staircases that go nowhere, just about everything you could possibly want. All wrapped in one small package. Well, the building we stood outside is the Creaky Cauldron in Henley Street, Stratford-on-Avon. It's the only remaining part of the, I suppose, infamous White Lion Inn. Now, the White Lion dates back to the 1500s, but the part that we're investigating dates back to the late 1500s, early 1600s, and late 1800s. Three completely different parts of the building that have three completely different ages. The building itself, over the 1500s and 1600s, ended up growing from the site that we have now to the end of the road and all the way down to Shakespeare's birthplace. Not only did it stretch a long way along Henley Street, but it also stretched all the way across to Guild Street. And in fact, stories say that it had over 300 rooms, including the stables and cellars, at its height, which was in the 1700s.
I've had two experiences here. Like, it's usually in the time room, which is upstairs. I was hoovering, closing up, so there's no one around. And someone tapped me on the shoulder, an actual tap on the shoulder, like heavy-handed, which was creepy, you know. Turned round, no one about, there's mirrors all over the room, couldn't see anything. And then there was another time where, which was quite recently actually, I was by the large mirror in the time room again, where I saw a little girl behind me, she was white gowned. I turned round, nothing was there. I looked back in the room, there was nothing around me.
Stu is the team psychometrist. Psychometry is a form of extrasensory perception where a person can gain knowledge of an object's history by making physical contact with it. The theory is that the object may have an energy field that can transfer into the person touching it, giving them valuable information about the past.
So let's just see what we can pick up here. Okay. Okay, the vision I'm getting, it's around about 1500, 1523 I'm pretty sure, something like that. There's an old woman in here who's been accused of witchery, and I can see a Puritan guy. He's wearing a Puritan hat with the ones with the big buckle on the top. There's two other officials with him, and they've come to arrest this woman. She's been accused of being a witch. The information I'm getting is she's actually a herbalist, and she'd mixed a concoction and gave it to this young child who was desperately ill, who subsequently ended up dying. The parents were informed that she was a witch and that she killed the child, and this is why she's been arrested. Okay. Just going to do a quick touch of the floor, as I feel there is something gone on in here. Okay, instantly what I'm feeling here is my hands in a sticky pool of blood. And what I'm getting here is there's a woman lying here who's been bludgeoned with the end of a pistol. There's a guy in here as well, and she's had her throat cut, and then he's stripped her and cut her all the way down the middle. This guy knew this person. I've got a name called Anne, and the guy I'm sure is called Robert, but I think he was a surgeon. He knew about anatomy, and he certainly knew about knives and blades, more a bit like the Ripper. But he didn't get caught. He got away with this one. Her age was probably late 20s. I think she was something to do with tailoring, seamstress. She used to make garments, blouses and dresses, I see. Very nice woman. Again, dark hair. Obviously, the guy who murdered her was a complete madman. And it's one of those relationships, I think, that she obviously got into but couldn't get out. And I think he was married. She got pregnant. She was going to tell the world that she was expecting his baby. He was having none of it because he was a well-known face in the town. And he decided to visit her and put an end to it. Then he left. And as I say, as far as I'm aware, he was never caught. There is also somewhere over here, there's a child. Okay, there's a child that stands and sits just here. I get the name Alice. And she's permanently here. And there is certainly an attachment, I know, between these two.
In 1788, a very brutal crime took place at the White Lion Inn. This is a matter of public record, and this crime that took place was a very, very scary thing indeed. A woman whose name was Annie was brutally murdered. And this is her story. It was a dark night, November, cold. There were very few people around and very few customers for Annie. She was a popular sort of woman at night, if you get my drift. She was a prostitute. Nothing happened. There were no customers. She was about to give the evening up as a dead loss when her eyes met those of a tall, dark-haired, handsome stranger. They quickly agreed terms and went up to one of the rooms in the building. As she turned round, the last thing she saw was the man walk towards her with a long, sharp knife in his hand. He slashed several times, almost completely severing her head, before plunging the knife deep into her chest and then, casting it to one side, ripping out her heart with his bare hands. Now, he would have got away with it had it not been for a witness. You see, there was a little girl on the landing outside, and she saw and heard everything. She cried out in horror. The murderer stopped what he was doing, wiped the blood from his hands, and went after the little girl. She turned and fled. By the time he reached the ground floor, the little girl had completely disappeared. So he too left the building. For 3 weeks, he laid low, terrified that the finger was going to be pointed, that he was going to be accused of the crime, which he had in fact committed. But there was no knock at the door. Nobody came up to him, nobody accused him. Just maybe he'd got away with it. Feeling braver, he came back out, came back to the inn, and imagine his surprise when he was greeted warmly by the landlord. "Come in, sir," said the landlord. "We haven't seen you for some weeks, not since the murder." At this, he was a little worried. Perhaps he had been fingered after all. "I suppose you want to talk about the murder," said the landlord. "Everybody does." And with that, he put a pint of ale on the table in front of him. "It was a terrible thing. There was a witness, you know, a little girl." And at this, the murderer began to be extremely worried. "But she was so terrified by what happened that she was struck dumb and hasn't spoken a word since." He breathed a sigh of relief. He had, in fact, got away with it. He supped his ale. Perhaps had another, we don't know. Maybe a third, a fourth, we really don't know. What we do know is at the end of the evening, he made his excuses and left by the main door of the inn, making certain that he was watched as he walked out of the door. But he didn't leave. What he did was come back in through a side door and then systematically search the entire building, looking for the little girl, the witness, the loose end. He searched every room, finally coming to the staircase that led back to the main floor of the ground part of the inn. And there she was, crying on the top step. He took a step towards her. She looked up. He took another step. A look of fear crossed her face. He took another step. She stood, she turned, she tripped, and she fell down the stairs. "The gods are with me," he thought. "She's dead."
This wooden chair is an original witch's chair, so we believe this is going to be, well, there is connections with witches when we're setting up the equipment earlier. The catering was going absolutely nuts. We've done a base reading in here, and there's absolutely nothing for it to, in theory, be setting off. So we've got a CCTV system set up all around the building, so we've got a static camera permanently on.
Well, it's gone up to Amber.
Okay, is there somebody with us here now? Are you listening to me? Are you going to come and talk to us later? How weird was that? So the K2 basically picks up electromagnetic fields. So in theory, any energies in this room, if they were to step towards that device, it triggers the lights to go up. For it to go up to red, depicts a fairly strong energy. So, in here is the theatre room. On the chair, we've got a teddy bear. We believe there to be a child energy in this room. So obviously the trigger object is related to the spirit that we believe is in this room. So, in the leg of the teddy bear is a K2 meter. Exactly the same as the one that we just filmed in the witch's room. And then on the actual table itself, we've got a geophone. Now that basically, it picks up on actual physical vibrations. So we know for a fact that as we walk in and out of this room, it is going to light up because it's just picking up the actual vibrations of us on the floor. So up to the top floor now.
Hello.
So down here is a little passageway, and there's been reports of shadows in this particular part of the building. So we've set up a laser grid. Again, we've got a permanent camera. It shines predominantly on the ceiling and on the floor. And I'll show you as I walk towards, you can see some of the lights disappearing. That's obviously picking up the fact that I'm here, my presence. We believe that there's been a shadow that's come from this direction out into the corridor. So again, that could potentially be picked up on the laser grids. And this is what's called the time room, I guess because of the amount of clocks in here. Originally this would have been a bedroom as part of the White Line Inn. And it's believed that there's two spirits that that haunt this part of the building. One of them, again, being a child. So we're going to use another trigger object. And this is a ball, as you can see. But if I pull out the tag, now in theory this will go off in about 4 minutes. We'll go back to how it was originally. We'll place it somewhere in this room, and again we've got static cameras on the room. If this gets moved, it will go back to green, so it'll be an easier way to spot that the ball has actually been touched by something. Okay, one of the things that we're going to be using on tonight's investigation is a REM pod. We're going to use the REM pod on temperature setting. So in theory, if it alarms out, then we know that the temperature around is changed, and there's no windows here. All the fans are switched off. There's pretty much no airflow. So if this does alarm out, then it will suggest potentially that there's something paranormal. So we'll see if the REM pod springs into life later.
Stu, we're going up to the time room, so what are we looking for?
Well, when I was up there, I picked up a woman called Annie and a little girl called Alice, and then there was a murder. So they're the two, you know, people we're looking for mainly, but there is the murderer as well. Now, I got the name Edward, but I believe now chatting to Dave, it was James. So perhaps we ought to be looking for a James. Okay. Definitely an Annie, definitely an Alice. Okay, so I know they're up there. Gruesome murder, really violent. So there should be a lot of energy up there. Let's see what you can get.
Yeah, let's take some kit up there and go and find them.
After Stu told us who we should be trying to communicate with, myself, Justin, and our other crew member, Stu, headed up to the time room for our first vigil of the night.
Right, we've spoken to Stu, so we're going to look for Annie or Alice or James. We've got a few things set up in here. We've got the REM pod here, which is on the temperature mode, so we can see if they're going to come and affect it, drop the temperature, if they can move towards a red light. We've also got a ball here as well, which should go off soon, so if that comes back on, we'll see if, in fact, if we put this down over in the doorway, there, we'll see if Alice wants to come and play with the ball as well. Right, Alice, are you here with us? Can you, there's a ball on the floor. Can you go and bring your energy towards that ball? Can you light it up for us, please? Well, we've got a red light here. If you take your energy towards that and make it go off, can you do that for us, please? Come on, Alice.
That was me.
Alice, come and join us. We don't mean you any harm. Can you come in and affect the red light on the table? I just see it. I've seen a flash go over there. Then.
Really?
Yeah.
What, a picture?
Just a flash.
Do you think it was the... Because I can't pick up on my camera all that well, the laser
grids. Move the camera around again. And again to your right. Like a white light just shoot across there. Just keep move the camera around that way and that way.
It could be the reflection. Well, I'm just saying that what I can see, you can't see because it's pitch black.
Now stand
here.
Where you were and move it round again because I just seen just. See that's not. It's not
see, it would only do it if I was to turn my whole screen round like that. See what I mean?
No, it wasn't like because I can see clearly off the reflection there that that's the screen, but that was like a white.
Hang on. We've got some action on the REM pod. Alice, if that's you affecting the REM pod, thank you. Can you step towards that pretty red light again for us, please?
Well, I thought I just seen something go past the... the timer, the sand timer, or whatever you call them.
What,
really?
Just before that went off?
No, just after when I looked, it was like a dark thing. It could have been a fly whizzing past, but we could see because I think I was filming anyway. Things.
There's definitely a lot of energy up here. I mean, as we know, there's a storm on its way, so I think that could help us to
build up the energy.
Yeah. Right, Alice, can you move towards the red light again, please? Can you make it go off? Make it beep.
I find that quite strange that you picked up on what you felt was like a white light.
Something. Yeah.
And then within what, 30 seconds, the
well,
red
it didn't
pod
recreate
reacts.
When it didn't recreate
well,
at all
that.
when you
it's not picked up on
camera
but
at all, so that was odd. And what did you see, Stuart?
Well, I thought I'd just seen like a little black I mean it could have been a fly, I don't know. It was just like something moved, you know, this way.
Yeah.
Hopefully I was filming. I mean, I've just seen a bit of dust in front of the thing here. It could have been that. But I've just seen it with my naked eye, not through the camera.
After reviewing the footage, we couldn't see the strange anomaly that Justin witnessed, and Stu's camera didn't capture the black shape he thought he saw in the viewfinder. At this point, we decided to try to capture some EVPs from the little girl that's believed to haunt the building.
Well, let's do a bit of an EVP session, see if we can get Alice to come and talk to us. What I'm going to do is I'm going to get down. Whoa. There it goes again.
Stay down, Justin, stay down. Okay, so that alarm is indicating a drop in temperature on the REM.
Right. Alice, if you're with us, come and talk to us, please. Come and talk to this silver box in my hand. Can you come and tell us your name, please? If I put this device over here, because you seem to like going towards this red light, can you come and talk to us, please?
Yeah, but I think it might be just something. Something did clock over near Justin, but it could be just.
Right.
So, like, the energy's building, if that makes sense.
Whoa, here we go. Wow.
On cue.
Yeah. Definitely felt like the energy was building, and I don't know why I felt like that.
I got chilled.
Okay, so you should chill because it is actually.
My hairs on my arms have stood up.
So.
Now, did we go over that EVP?
Everything has just gone off, Andy.
K2?
Down in the witch's chair.
Whereabouts?
Oh, this one's going now. This one's going now, here.
Well, we've got one going here now.
Yeah.
What? Well, right, now, if I stand back here... Is that set?
Yeah.
Setting off?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. I would say that's officially debunked.
Yeah, we've just tested it, mate. But it's not setting the REM pod off, because
if that's on
temperature, I'm going to do a little test now. Why is that going like that now? That didn't do that before, did it?
Can you just double check that it's on temp? You need your torch for that.
Drawing on one bar on air now.
Yeah, it's definitely on temp.
Okay. How long does it take to charge up?
Right, now that's setting it off if I'm near it, but...
K2, yeah, that's definitely affected by the
torch. Yeah, but it's not affecting the REM though, so...
After testing the walkie-talkie with our equipment, we successfully debunked the readings on the K2. However, the REM pod only activated when Justin's walkie-talkie was near to it, and being as the REM pod triggered when our team either saw or felt something, we believe this to be a spirit trying to communicate. Following this, we listened to the EVP that our digital recorder had picked up.
I see what we've caught on this EVP then. There's something there, definitely.
Oh God, what was that?
That is, there's a sentence there with that we need to review that, definitely.
On reviewing this EVP, we believe it to be a response from Annie asking for our help. Unfortunately, on the night, the speaker on the audio recorder gave us the impression it was a male's voice, hence Justin began asking questions towards James.
That sounded like a male presence to me, so I'm wondering if we've got, if James is with us. James?
Whoa. Yes.
Okay, I think he might have hit the nail on the head.
Does that mean we've got James with us? I've just got a right shiver all down my body then. As soon as I said
yeah,
it.
Yeah, no, I've seen my head.
Right, okay. So, it definitely sounded like a male's voice.
Right, get him to speak into the box.
Well, I'm going to stand up now because I think we've got this James with us. So, I'm not sitting down for him.
Go again.
Right, James, if you're with us, can you tell me why you committed the murders you did here? Can you come and tell me, because I think you're a disgusting man for what you did. You murdered Annie right here in this room, and Alice as well. Now come towards me. If you're that much of a man, come towards me and talk to me. If you're not happy with me being here, come and talk to me. Come and tell me what you've got to tell me. Right, James, if you're with us, take your energy towards... Oh, I've just felt something touch my neck.
Really?
Yeah.
What, as in something grabbed you, it's or like, just like a poke?
Something just tugged on my jeans then.
Well, that's there. Where Annie's body was found. That's where she was murdered, where you actually stood.
Right. It's like weird. Just like a tug on my jean, that was. That was weird. Right, we go. Come on, James. I'm not scared of you. Come on, James. Come and set this red light off again. Come and do something. Come and touch one of us. If you're not happy about us being here, talk into this silver box and tell us to get out.
We concluded our first vigil excited by the evidence we'd obtained. We went back downstairs to discuss our findings with the rest of the group.
We got some REM pod.
Yeah, some brilliant action, yeah.
Good.
Yeah, some direct hits. As soon as we mentioned names, we...
You've got some good names.
Yeah, brilliant. We've got some... As soon as we mentioned James and Alice, we got some hits straight away on the REM pod. Yeah, we got a voice. It was a male voice because we initially
we picked up Alice.
But yeah. The EVP sounded more like a male's voice, so I said, right, we've got James here. And on as soon as I'd finished saying James, beam, on the REM pod, straight off.
You've got to be seen to go and try and debunk it. Someone's keeping that on permanently.
Look, here we go, it's going up again.
Is that recording, Stu?
It's all up then, right.
That is on contact.
Okay, so we've got a load of lights going off here, so guys, I think you've got to get up there and find out why, okay?
So we're going to go up now with the K2 meter, and we're going to do a little bit of science, see if there's anything up there that might be setting the K2 off, which has gone off in the room at the front of the building. See if we can try and debunk what's going on up there.
It's gone right up.
It's full on now.
Right then.
I know if there's any Wi-Fi. There's no Wi-Fi, I don't think, is there, Dave? No Wi-Fi up there, no electric on.
Who have we got up here with us then?
Well, you're going to go.
Okay. So at the moment, you can see the K2 meter, which is sat in the witch's ducking chair, is going off at the moment. These are designed to pick up man-made EMF signals, but some people suspect that spirits can make these meters flicker. So I'm going to go around now with this second K2 meter and see if we can find out where the source of this energy is coming from. Okay, you can see there's absolutely no change there whatsoever. And there you have it. So whatever is affecting that K2 meter there is not affecting this K2 meter. Okay, so that K2 meter is now turned off. There we go, it's gone back to nothing. But there is There's nothing affecting it anymore. We'll swap these two K2 meters round. If this K2 meter goes off again tonight in this exact position, then we'll know it's not just down to one potentially being faulty. Okay. There we go. You can see there's this. That's the other K2 meter. That is not the same K2 meter. Is there anything around
here? It's nothing to do with that cage or anything.
Like a Faraday cage effect. Yeah, it could well be this.
There's some holding some sort of charge.
Charge or something on that cage, but it's not setting the other one off now, look. There's nothing setting that one off now. In fact, it's gone completely.
Who's in the chair?
How strange. Now we've got two K... It's going up again. We've got two K2 meters here now that are both... See, it's gone back to normal. These K2 meters are both going up and down randomly here.
Following this, Stu, Stewboy and our guest investigator Andy went up to the theatre room to try a spirit box session. During this time, nothing evidential was captured in the way of voices, but it did, however, seem to offer a different kind of evidence.
Bring your energy to this voice of yours. How many fingers am I holding up? Yeah. Okay, if you want to communicate through a noise, I'm going to turn this off.
Our cameraman Stewboy heard a single bump noise after Stew asked how many fingers he was holding up. On analysing the footage, it actually comes from the SP7, and when Stew asked if they wanted to communicate through noise, he turns the device off. As he does, this strange tapping sound comes through the speaker, which hadn't occurred previously.
How many fingers am I holding up? Okay, if you want to communicate through a noise, I'm going to turn this off. Okay, it's quiet now.
What was that?
We just had a flash of light.
Yeah, what was that?
Is there a device over there? There must be a device over there somewhere.
Where?
And again.
There.
And again.
There it is.
What's that?
What have we got going off there? Is that a REM pod?
The blue LED on the side of the REM pod indicates a 5 or more degree drop in temperature. Could the spirit with the team be using this as a form of communication?
Maybe we should ask spirit if they can affect it in any other way.
Okay, spirits, could you... All of your energies, could you make this light come on again? Make all four lights, blue light, use all your energy to make it flash. Nice one.
That's an immediate response.
Yeah, that was very good. Okay, could you make a noise? Could you knock or move something? Yes. Okay, let's say one flash for yes, two flashes for no. Are you with us? Use your energy. One flash for yes. Two flashes for no. Okay, it looks like your energy's...
Well, it wasn't... I thought it might be... I counted it between the flashes. I thought, well, if it's the same, it's obviously... But yeah. It wasn't.
Okay, let's ask you another way. One flash for male, two flashes for female. Female. Are you young? One flash. Old, two flashes.
One flash.
Two flashes.
So you're an old lady.
As you were talking, once again, as you were talking and asking that, and you'll see it on the camera here, you got the one flash.
Okay, let's try again. So you're two for old. One for yes, two for no. Are you old? Okay, let's see if we can copy something. Copy me.
Oh, wow. See it. You went bang, bang. Well done.
That is fantastic.
Let's try one.
I'm getting cold. Got the chill over me.
Yeah. Come in, come nearer to us. Try that again. Is that one?
You just got the one and the another one.
Right, let's try it. Nice. Okay, well, you're with us now. Wow, that's excellent. Keep it going. You're there. Nice one. That's good. Two
that's
on
fantastic.
That.
Fantastic. Very,
okay.
Very good.
Let's really throw it to you. Let's do three.
Yay.
That's great.
Okay, I think
one,
we
two,
get the walkie-talkie and we get
that?
Justin up here to explain what that is to us.
Okay, so what's going on, guys? We've just been upstairs and we were hanging around outside the chapter room. Justin's just been up there and tell us what happened, mate.
As soon as I moved into the energy, I nearly fainted.
Jesus Christ. I felt like someone had pushed me.
No, nobody's touching me.
Fucking hell.
You lose your balance?
I feel really like I'm going to faint.
I just went all dizzy and went. I don't feel 100% now, but I feel better now. I've come back downstairs, so I'm going to go off and do a bit of a lone vigil now in that room and see what we can get.
Okay.
Okay.
Feeling
right.
Brave.
Yep. Let's go for it.
Got DR60 with you?
No, I haven't got anything. I'm just going to sit there and call out.
Justin headed back upstairs alone with no equipment other than his video camera to try and communicate with whatever had just affected him so badly in the theatre room.
We've been getting some activity in this room with a teddy bear that's got the K2 meter in it. The geophone. I don't feel right in this room at all. Right. Whoever's in here, can you tap on the table, please? Can you make those lights flash again? Or can you move towards a teddy bear?
Justin calls out asking for visual or audio responses, but nothing happens until about 10 minutes in when he starts to hear footsteps and knocks.
Thud upstairs then. Who's up there? It's not the nicest thing to see, is it, when you get to the top of the stairs? Of how dark it is and what I can see. That's pretty much it. I'll switch that back on now. Right, James? Are you here with me? Come on, I'm not scared of you. I heard you when I was downstairs making noise up here. Now come and do it now, I'm here, come on. talking from outside. Oh, two big orbs down there. Is that a fly? It's got to be a fly, surely. That's coming straight towards me. That's coming towards me. Where's that? What was that? And another one. Come on! Alice, are you here? Can you come here? Come here, please. Come and talk to me. Can you copy me? Do you want to play a game? If you were murdered here, Annie, can you try and copy me, please? Come on, who's here? Did it come from in this room? There's a definite noise out there. After I tapped, where the hell did that come from? Are you hiding from me? Because if I sit in here now, you're going to make a noise in that other room again, aren't you? Go on then, if you want to play games, make a bang in the other room again.
No more knocks were heard by Justin. It appears that whatever was making the noises was playing with him as they were occurring in different rooms. He returned to the group whereby myself, Andy and our cameraman Stu prepared for our own vigil.
Okay, Nat, so your vigil?
Yes.
Where are you going?
I fancy going up to the top room, the very top room at the front of the property.
Yeah.
That's the room that I feel the most scared in.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I don't know what it is about that room, so when I go up there, who am I looking for?
Well, when I did a walk round and I picked up a guy... they used to call the bull.
Right.
So he's a very, very heavy, bad man in life. He was basically a thug. And I suppose you had to be in them days, but it turned him into a nasty character. So I think when you go up there, he is in the residual energy there. He's in the shadows as well.
So he's not going to particularly like us being in that room?
I very much doubt it.
Okay.
I think you'd have to be careful not to overstep the mark, so just take it step by step. I think get a contact and like you're a customer really, but if you go in there shouting and threatening him and wind him up, I think he'll just come bomb straight down on you.
Right.
That's my gut instinct anyway.
Okay.
But John the Bull is the landlord of this establishment when it was a pub.
Okay.
See how you get on. Have fun.
Okey-dokey.
So,
we are currently on the top floor of the Creaky Cauldron, and what I've been told by Stu is that this particular room has the presence of an energy called John Payton. Going on what Stu said, that this John character doesn't particularly like people being in here, I would understand why if this is where his money is. So what I've done is I've set up the REM pod and I've put a coin on the top. It's balancing at the moment, and some coins there just to see if that might attract John towards the money. John, if you're here and you want me to leave, if you want us to leave, try and make your presence known. Try and scare me in some way. Try and get rid of me. Try and move me on from your place. Either do that by touching me, making a banging noise. Apparently shadows have been captured in the corridor next to me. Try and recreate a shadow. Walk down the corridor. There's lots of strange lights in your space. None of them will harm you. All they're doing is trying to detect your energy. So come towards me, John. John, if you're here with us, make your presence known, please. Come towards my voice. Try and shout in my ear. Try and say something now for me, please.
John, don't you like talking to women? Do you have a problem with Nat being here?
Time I was in here, I did feel this is the room I wouldn't want to do a lone vigil in here normally.
Guys, K2's going mad on the witch's.
We continued with this vigil for a short while but received no further evidence, so we decided to head downstairs to see if we could contact whoever was affecting the K2 meter on the witch's chair. Okay, we've been here most of the night and on and off. For some reason your energy is floating in and out of this room. Is it this particular room that you like to stay in? If you're not in this room at the moment but you can hear my voice, can you come towards my voice please? Come back into this room, affect us in some way. Are you smelling anything different?
I smell something out here, but I'm thinking, is it from the shop down below? I smelled this smell earlier on as well.
I'm getting it, yeah.
Like a perfume smell.
Yes, like a...
Oh, some sort of, yeah.
But it's gone really strong and like a lavendery.
Oh,
sweet.
Oh,
scent.
My lord. I've got it here, right.
Really?
That really strong.
It's a bit...
It's gone again.
I can't smell it at all now.
Yeah.
Oh my god! Oh my god! Seriously, I very rarely pick up on stuff like that, but that just literally hit me like a wall.
I mean, it's not from downstairs.
Okay, I'm getting it as well now.
Oh wow!
I know it's got smelly stuff downstairs, but it's like real. I smelled this earlier on when I was up here, and I thought,
it's
just
really strong again. really strange. It's almost like it's coming and going, but
yeah.
I mean, the amount of ghost sense I've done, I'd never pick up on stuff like that.
I've got it again, really strong again now. Are you making this smell? Are you showing us a sign?
Are you smelling it still, Andy? It's almost like it comes and then it goes again. And yeah. I'm almost getting like a really cold chill.
My hairs on my arms are right off.
If that's you making that smell, that beautiful smell, if that's you, thank you. Can you make the light flicker just to confirm, yes, that's you doing it? Can you try and do that for us, please? I've got something in my hand that can potentially pick up your voice. Can you try and talk to me, please? If that's you making that smell, that sweet smell, can you try and say yes for me, please?
Wow.
I know you're trying to talk to me. We're picking your voice up. If you can hear it, you know now. Thank you. The lights are going off. So you know that the things that we've brought into this room are here to try and talk to you. So after three, I want you to use as much energy as you can to say your name. 1, 2, 3. I would like a clear yes or no answer. Were you happy here? Can I have a yes or no, please?
Whoa.
Worth of history, is it easy to assume that the Creaky Cauldron is haunted? The Haunted Britain team have picked up some compelling evidence from very strong EVPs through to the devices being triggered.
Whoa, here we go.
Along with the team members feeling strange sensations.
Oh, Christ.
Oh my God! Oh my God, seriously. It's the Creaky Cauldron on the Haunted Britain list. I'm pleased to say that this location is haunted.